Today, we all start with a brand new chapter, module number 5, titled Rectifiers and Filters for the subject Electronic Devices, abbreviated ED, with the subject code ACC302. Once again, welcome to the entire class of SE Electronics and Computer Science Semester 3. From the point of view of the syllabus, module number 5, Rectifiers and Filters, contains two main sections, unit number 5.1. along with unit number 5.2. The first half, unit number 5.1, contains different types of diode rectifier circuits, which include the center tapped full wave rectifier circuit and the bridge type full wave rectifier circuit. We'll be studying about the circuit diagram, the operation, the principle of working, along with mathematical analysis, which include derivations for expressions of the DC or the average voltage, the RMS output voltage, the DC or the average output current, the RMS output current, and most importantly, ripple factor. This section also contains several numerical examples which we need to solve. Unit number 5.2 describes different types of filters, such as the capacitor filter, the inductor filter, the inductor capacitor, commonly called as the LC filter, and finally the CLC or the PI filter, which we will all take up later on. Before we proceed further, today's section is focused completely on the full wave center tapped rectifier circuit. So, going on, the prerequisite knowledge required for this particular session is a good understanding about semiconductor physics, which we have once again already studied way back in semester 1 for the subject Engineering Physics 1. Along with this, we also need to understand the PN junction diode and applications, which was previously covered in lecture number 2 for module number 1, which was from unit number 1.1. If you in case want to just do a small revision, the YouTube link as well as the QR code is given. You can simply scan the QR code, which will direct you towards the particular YouTube link video lecture. Moving on, the first question that we need to ask ourselves is, why rectifiers are required? The first thing, what is the need for them? If I show you the first two images in this on this particular slide, what you will see is that these are a lot of electronic gadgets, electronic devices, electronic systems, which we have all been using since the early 20th century and in the late 20th century and the early 21st century, something without which our lives are currently impossible to visualize. In the first half of the image, you can see a calculator, a remote control, a IPTV console, various computer peripherals like a headphone, mouse, mobile phone, cordless phone, tablet, etc. And here you are able to see cameras, joysticks, headphones, etc. These are all gadgets that we use somewhere or the other, and they have become a part of our daily lives. So I am not wrong if I say that these are commonly used electronic gadgets of computing, communication, and entertainment purposes for practical and real life daily applications. Apart from using these gadgets properly, reading the entire instruction manual, following the do's and don'ts, or making them work at a proper optimum temperature, handling them carefully, one very important thing about all your electronic gadgets, about all your electronic devices to work, is that all of them need a stable, a smooth, and a continuous power supply for their operation. Everybody agrees with that. When we say stable and smooth, the obvious choice would be ultimately DC. And we derive DC supply from batteries. So while this particular supply is stable and smooth, but is it continuous? Or how long can the batteries last? What about the capacity? For certain gadgets like your say laptops, batteries can last for typically 5 to 6 to 8 hours. You definitely do not have a battery that lasts the full 24 hours. So somewhere or the other, there is a small limitation about the DC supply which is derived from batteries. So how long can batteries last, and what about the capacity, is the main question we now have to answer. An alternate solution is to use a continuous power supply of 230 volts AC 50 hertz, which all of us are getting at our homes. So of course, apart from barring power shutdowns, blackouts, load shedding, etc., we all have a permanent connection of AC 230 volt supply 50 hertz at our houses. Industries use a slightly higher voltage of 440 volts AC 50 hertz, and that is typically three phase. We use over here single phase. So you have a continuous power supply by AC. So AC takes care of the need continuous, while DC takes care of stable and smooth. Now, why do we use AC when all our electronics works purely on DC? Well, the answer to this particular question is, it is from the point of view of safety, efficiency, and economics that AC is suitable for transmission and distribution as compared to DC. It is very easy to step up AC, step down AC using transformers, but it is very difficult to do the same for DC. And of course, when AC is actually transmitted, the transmission efficiency is actually high. The losses are minimum, or in this case, very, very less. So when AC is generated, it is always easier to transmit AC compared to transmitting DC. Okay, all these things are fine. But how do we obtain DC from AC? At our homes, we are getting AC. So we assume that we have a continuous supply of AC. How do we convert that AC into DC? Well, the answer lies in using rectifiers. These are electronic circuits that use PN junction diodes to convert or change or modify, or in this case, rectify the AC into DC. Since the name is here, rectify, we get the word over here, rectifiers. Now, using common logic, the name also could have been convertifier, changifier, modifier, but somehow, according to me, rectifier picks up the best possible spot. So basically, rectifiers are circuits, they are devices that use PN junction diodes to simply convert AC into DC. According to the syllabus, this is one of the main rectifier circuits that we'll be studying. The name is center tapped full wave rectifier. Looking at the circuit, you will immediately notice one thing. It has been drawn by four different colors. Reason being, many students normally ask that how to start drawing and what is the proper process of drawing a typical center tap full wave rectifier circuit without making mistakes. Well, the answer lies in following a step-by-step process. The first thing is you have is an AC input supply, which is 230 volts AC 50 hertz. This AC supply is directly applied to the primary windings of a center tapped transformer, which has the turns ratio 1:1:1. This means whatever voltage is available at the primary side, the same voltage will be available on the two halves of the secondary side as well. So this voltage repeats across the upper half, and the same voltage repeats across the lower half as well. So the part shown in blue is nothing but that of a center tapped transformer. Moving beyond this, we have two PN junction diodes. One is diode D1, one is diode D2. These two diodes are connected to the upper half and the lower half of the secondary windings. So we have the anode of diode D1 connected to the secondary winding upper half. We have the anode of diode D2 connected to the lower half of the secondary windings. The cathodes of these two are connected to be common. And finally, we have the load RL that is connected across the PN junction diode's cathode terminal and the center tapped winding over here. The potential at the center tapped winding is thought of as ground potential or 0 volts. So these four elements, the input AC power supply, the center tap transformer, the diodes D1 and D2, along with the load RL, form the circuit diagram of the center tap full wave rectifier circuit. Looking at the description, the input is typically a AC power supply of 230 volts 50 hertz. We have a center tapped transformer typically having a 1:1:1 configuration, with the secondary center tapped being connected down to ground. we have two PN junction diodes. One is D1, which is connected to the upper half of the center tap transformer secondary winding. And we have the second PN junction diode D2, which is connected to the lower half of the center tap transformer secondary winding. And finally, the load RL is connected between the center tap of the transformer secondary and to the cathode terminals of D1 and D2. It is across this particular load resistor RL that the rectified output voltage is obtained. Let us see the operation. Since the input AC supply is alternating, you have one half cycle positive from 0 to pi, and you have the second half cycle negative from pi to 2 pi. So in the very first instant, when you have the positive half cycle of operation, you have the transformer primary windings get polarities as the top part is positive, the bottom part is negative. Now this voltage or these polarities due to the 1:1:1 configurations are transferred exactly from the primary down to the secondary. So here we have plus and minus. We have plus and minus here. So what we see is that the 1:1:1 configuration gives us the same polarities throughout, plus minus on the primary side, plus minus and plus minus on the secondary side. From the point of view of the PN junction diode connection, what we are able to see is the anode of diode D1 is at a positive potential compared to the cathode, because the cathode is shown connected to the center tap transformer secondary winding. Similarly, for the PN junction diode D2, the anode is connected to the lower half of the secondary winding, which is having a negative potential, while the cathode is having a positive potential with respect to the center tapped secondary winding as shown. Now plus goes to anode of D1, minus goes to cathode of diode D2. It is very easy to guess. Diode D1 becomes forward biased, diode D2 becomes reverse biased. This whole particular condition can be easily shown by this. So what you see is you have the peak voltage appearing at the primary side. The same peak voltage due to a 1:1:1 configuration appears also across the secondary side as well, with plus minus, plus minus. And since the diode D1 is forward biased, it simply acts like a short circuit or a closed switch. But on the other hand, diode D2 will be reverse biased. It will be acting like an open switch or as an open circuit. From the secondary side, you find that the upper half forms a closed loop circuit, but the lower half forms an open loop circuit. So in the lower half, there is no question of any current flowing due to the open loop connection. But yes, there is a current I1 which is flowing in the upper half of the secondary winding. The direction of this current is given as clockwise. The reason being that you have a plus sign on top, a minus sign below. Current will always flow from a point of high potential to a point of low potential. So this current I1 gets a direction of clockwise. As the current flows in the loop, it also flows through RL. So as the current I1 enters RL from the right side, you get a plus sign. And when the current I1 leaves RL from the other side, from the left side, you get a sign of minus. This is exactly following the KVL notations. So RL has a voltage V out, which is positive because the negative half or the negative side is connected to the center tapped winding. So you have a positive voltage V out available across the load RL. So what do we see? We see that for the primary winding, the upper half has a positive potential while the lower half has a negative potential. For the secondary winding, the upper half has a positive and the lower half a negative potential with respect to the center tapped of 0 volts. Due to this, diode D1 turns on and conducts for the entire half cycle from 0 to pi, which virtually behaves like a short circuit, while the diode D2 remains off or behaves like an open circuit. The upper half of the secondary winding is able to establish a closed circuit path with a clockwise current through the load resistor RL. And this particular sinusoidal clockwise current, which passes through the load RL, causes a positive voltage drop across it, with respect to the center tap connection given at 0 volts. That was the case for the positive half cycle from 0 to pi. Similarly, when we take the negative half cycle into now operation, the polarities are currently reversed, because here we have the negative half cycle which will exist from pi to 2 pi. So we have the topmost part negative, we have the bottommost part positive, and due to the 1:1:1 configuration, the same polarities are repeated across both the halves of the secondary winding also. So we have the upper half with the signs minus and plus, we have the lower half with the signs minus and plus again. From the point of view of diode D1, the anode is connected to the negative potential. The anode for diode D2 is connected to the positive potential. Both are with respect to the ground level potential at the center tap of 0 volts. Since minus goes to anode and plus goes to the anode over here, it is very easy to guess that now for the negative half cycle operation, D1 will act like a reverse bias condition, open loop. But D2 will be forward biased because you have a positive potential at the anode and a negative potential at the cathode. So the equivalent circuit will be exactly like this. Now in the reverse case of operation, D1 is off. Reverse bias, so no current flows through it. However, D2 turns on because it is now forward biased. So you have a lot of current flowing through the lower half of the loop compared to the upper half. The sign is minus plus. The same signs are now repeated. So you have minus plus here, minus plus over here. And since current flows from a point of high to a point of low potential, you have the current I2 flowing in a counterclockwise direction. But this doesn't affect the voltage drop across RL, because again for this case, the current I2 enters RL from the right side with the plus sign. It leaves RL from the left side with a minus sign. So this gives you a positive output voltage with respect to the center tap transformer ground level potential of 0 volts. So here you have a positive output voltage obtained across the load. Looking at the description, for the primary winding, the upper half has a negative potential while the lower half has a positive potential. For the secondary winding, the lower half has a positive and the upper half has a negative potential with respect to the center tapped winding, which has a potential of 0 volts. This causes diode D2 to turn on and conduct for the remaining half cycle from pi to 2 pi, behaving like a short circuit. While diode D1 remains off, it will behave like an open circuit. Conversely, you have the lower half of the secondary winding establishing a closed circuit path with the anti-clockwise current direction that flows through the load RL. So this particular sinusoidal anti-clockwise current that passes through RL will cause it to have a positive voltage drop with respect to the center tap of 0 volts. And this operation can be graphically shown by the input and the output waveforms. Your Vin was the 230 volts AC RMS 50 hertz AC input signal as shown. It's 230 volts AC 50 hertz, and you have a maximum peak value of plus Vm. You have a negative peak value of minus Vm. Keep in mind that for AC signals, we can easily obtain the amplitude in terms of RMS value, peak value, or peak to peak value. Here the output shows the rectified output voltage which is positively pulsating DC. Although the quadrant is quadrant number one, meaning the voltage is not going negative. However, you can see that it has a lot of pulsations or a lot of variations that start from zero and they go right up to Vm. You even have breaks in between at pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, 4 pi. So although the output is somewhere close to being DC, it is not perfectly DC because the voltage waveform is not flat. It's not a straight flat line. You can't call it DC. So this rectified output voltage has a DC component and it has an AC component as well. The DC component comes due to the fact that the voltage is changing positively only from 0 to Vm. The AC component is due to the fact that you have sinusoidal variations in the output signal voltage, suggesting that the output rectified voltage is a mixture of the AC component and the DC component too. For the first half cycle from 0 to pi, you have D1 on and D2 off. From pi to 2 pi, we have D1 off and D2 on. From 2 pi to 3 pi, we again have D1 on while D2 is off. And finally, from 3 pi to 4 pi, we have D1 off and D2 on. This is an alternate cycle of operation where diode D1 remains off for one half cycle and diode D2 turns on for the other half cycle. The same process continues further. Now, for the output voltage, we need to perform the following mathematical analysis. We need to derive expressions for the DC output or the average voltage given by the term VDC, the DC output or the average current given by the term IDC, the RMS value of the AC output voltage given by VRMS, the RMS value of the AC output current given by IRMS, and finally, ripple factor gamma. Ripple factor is very important because it tells us the ratio of the AC component in the output with respect to the DC component. Ideally, you do not want any AC component present in the rectifier output voltage because the goal is to convert AC into DC. So in the later half of this session, we'll be focusing on the mathematical analysis as well as numerical examples based on the DC output voltage and current, the AC output voltage and current, along with the ripple factor as well. Starting with the first part, the DC output or the DC average voltage, here I am using the term VDC. Now, this is the same waveform which is shown for Vout. And you can see that the waveform is continuously oscillating between 0 to Vm, although it is maintaining a positive peak value throughout. If I'm not wrong, I can easily write the equation for Vout as equal to Vm into sine omega t between the limits 0 to pi. The same equation is also applicable to the limits pi to 2 pi, 2 pi to 3 pi, 3 pi to 4 pi, and so on and so forth, because the shape is exactly that of a sinusoidal waveform. So this curve follows the equation Vout is equal to Vm into sine omega t, something which we have all learned way back in semester 1, BEE, the standard equation for a sinusoidal waveform. To calculate the DC output or the average voltage VDC, the formula is given by area under the curve over the cycle divided by the length of the base, because for this particular curve here, the area under the curve is divided by the length of the base, which will give us the average value. Please focus on the terms area under the curve over the cycle divided by the length of the base. If you look at the word area under the curve, it clearly means that the mathematical operation used to calculate area under the curve is nothing but integration. And when you say the curve was defined by the equation Vout is equal to Vm into sine omega t. When you say over the cycle, the one cycle is lasting from the limits 0 to pi, pi to 2 pi, 3 pi to 4 pi, etc. So if we take the first cycle over here, the limits are clearly from 0 to pi. And the length of the base, the length of the base is exactly pi. This difference is pi. This difference is also pi. The same is applicable here and the same is applicable here too. So the length of the base is pi. This particular English translation can be converted into a mathematical formula by this way. So we get VDC is equal to integration 0 to pi Vm sine theta d theta, the whole term upon pi. This is exactly in conjunction with what we get the equation as area under the curve over the cycle divided by the length of the base. So this gives us VDC is equal to integral 0 to pi Vm sine theta d theta, the whole term upon pi. Solving this, the constant terms are Vm and pi. Both can be taken common as outside. So we get Vm upon pi integral 0 to pi sine theta d theta. With these two terms being constant, we have Vm upon pi. The integration of sine theta simply gives us minus cos theta, and the definite integration limits are from 0 to pi. So here we have the limits from 0 to pi. If you are confused, I've just replaced the argument omega t with the term theta, because it becomes easier for us to have a single argument theta as compared to having omega t throughout. The minus sign being constant can be taken outside. So we have VDC is equal to minus Vm by pi cos theta. The limits are again 0 to pi. If we put in the limits, we get VDC is equal to minus Vm upon pi, brackets open, cos pi minus cos 0. And solving them, we get VDC is equal to minus Vm by pi, brackets open, minus 1, minus 1. Reason being that cos pi is minus 1, cos of 0 is equal to minus 1. So we get minus Vm upon pi, brackets open, minus 1, minus 1, which simplifies down to VDC is equal to twice Vm upon pi. If we look at equation number 7, 2 is a constant, pi is a constant. Vm was the maximum or the peak signal amplitude, which cannot be solved further. So it is impossible to solve equation number 7 further, because we only have constant terms like Vm, 2 and pi. So the average or the DC output voltage for a center tapped full wave rectifier circuit is simply given by the equation VDC is equal to twice Vm upon pi. And that's your first major equation for the average or the DC output voltage. On an exactly similar lines, we can show the value of VDC here. So this line VDC shows the level of the DC or the average output voltage. If I go backwards, 2 upon pi is roughly 0.637. So you have a 63.7% of DC component of your maximum peak signal amplitude, which is hidden in this particular rectified output voltage as shown. So this is nothing but VDC or the average DC output voltage. Similarly, to calculate the DC output or the average value of current, the same formulation applies. You have IDC is equal to integration 0 to pi Im into sine theta d theta, the whole term upon pi. Please look at equation number 1 carefully. DDC is replaced by IDC. Vm is simply replaced by Im. So you have Im is nothing but the maximum or the peak value of the current of the sinusoidal component. And since Im and pi are both constant terms, they can be taken out, and the integration is purely of sine theta d theta from the limits 0 to pi. The same derivation continues with the same possible set of steps. You can take out the minus sign common. You have minus Im upon pi. Limits are 0 to pi for cos theta. You put in the limits, the equation becomes minus Im upon pi, brackets open, cos pi minus cos 0, which again solves it down to equation number 7 given by IDC is equal to twice Im upon pi. This is exactly similar to the DC output or the DC average voltage, which was VDC equal to twice Vm upon pi. So that's the equation IDC, which is given by twice Im upon pi. A different alternate way to obtain the average or the DC current is by using Ohm's law, where IDC is equal to simply VDC upon RL. As we had seen earlier, the upper and lower half of the secondary transformer windings were simply following Ohm's law. You had a maximum voltage Vm, you had a maximum current Im, and you had the load RL. So Ohm's law is currently applicable there. We have IDC is equal to twice Vm by pi divided by RL, and slightly rearranging all these terms, we get the equation for IDC is equal to twice Vm divided by pi into the value RL. And that's the alternate expression for the average or the DC output current. Going for the AC output or the RMS voltage, here we should keep one thing in mind that although I'm mentioning AC output, technically we are actually calculating the RMS value of the AC component. So the RMS value of the AC component is given by the formula VRMS is equal to square root integration 0 to pi Vm sine theta the whole term square divided by pi. RMS is root mean square. So we have the root sign here. We have the root sign here as well. And this is integration 0 to pi upon pi. So the mean part comes over here and square. The curve is squared up. So we have Vm sine theta the whole thing squared up. Going further, what I'll do is I'll keep the square root sign as it is because nothing much can be done. I'll take out the constant terms first. The constant terms for me are one term is Vm square and the other term is pi. So the integration sign only contains sine square theta d theta between the limits 0 to pi. Now using our knowledge of school college level trigonometry, sine square theta can be replaced by the terms 1 minus cos 2 theta upon 2. I've simply converted sine square theta into 1 minus cos 2 theta upon 2. The integration, the process remains exactly as it is. From equation number 3, what I'll do is I'll simply split the integration part as, before that I'll be just taking out the term, the denominator 2 as common out. So we get Vm square upon 2 pi integration 0 to pi brackets open 1 minus cos 2 theta d theta. And in equation number 5, we'll cause it to split. So we have one part as integration d theta because 1 multiplied by d theta gives you d theta minus the second part gives you 0 to pi integration cos 2 theta d theta. Now this is from the linearity property of integration. Solving them, we get VRMS is equal to square root Vm square upon 2 pi brackets open integration of d theta is simply theta and integration of cos 2 theta will be sine 2 theta upon 2. The limits for both the cases are common, so we have the common limits from 0 to pi. The next equation lies in putting the limits into the argument. So we have VRMS is equal to square root Vm square by 2 pi brackets open. Now theta has been replaced by the upper limit of pi, the lower limit of 0 minus 2 is of course common. So we have sine of 2 theta replaced by the upper limit of sine 2 pi minus sine of 0. Looking at the equation number 7, it is very easy to guess sine of 2 pi is 0, sine of 0 is 0 because sine of 2 pi is nothing but the entire angle or the entire cycle from 0 to 360 degrees. So equation number 7 simplifies down to VRMS is equal to square root Vm square upon 2 pi brackets open pi minus 0 is the same sine 2 pi is 0 0 upon 2 is 0 minus and minus give you plus 0 upon 2 gives you ultimately 0. So it is very simple to guess the pi terms cancel out. You get VRMS is equal to square root of Vm square by 2. And this goes down to the standard formula of VRMS is equal to Vm by root 2. Now this equation cannot be solved further. This is nothing but the RMS value of the AC component present in the rectified output voltage. On an exactly similar grounds, the output voltage can be shown as shown. So we have VRMS given by a positive sign. And if you go back to the equation, 1 upon root 2 is roughly 0.707. So we have the RMS value of the AC component as 70.7 times the peak or the maximum signal value as shown. So although I mentioned AC output, technically this is the RMS level or the RMS level measurement of the AC component present in the rectified output voltage. Exactly similar, the RMS current will follow the same set of equations. So we can easily calculate the RMS current value just as we did for VRMS. The only major difference here is that in place of VRMS, we are having IRMS, and in place of Vm, we are having Im. The procedure to calculate the RMS current component is exactly the same. So we'll be just going it through. The same part, splitting them both, integrating both the terms separately, putting in the limit values. So theta is from 0 to pi as shown, and we get the same value. So there's no marks in guessing that IRMS is definitely equal to Im upon the value root 2. And that's the equation for the RMS or the AC output current as shown. And finally, we go to the ripple factor, which is called as gamma. Technically, ripple factor is defined as the ratio of the RMS value of the AC component to the DC component present in the rectified output. And since the output current of the center tap full wave rectifier circuit contains both DC and AC components, by definition, the effective RMS value of the total output current is given by IRMS is equal to square root IDC square plus IAC square. Now, if we want to remove IAC and make it a typical standalone term, what we'll do is we will just square both the sides and transfer the term IDC square from right to left. So this gives us IAC is equal to square root IRMS square minus IDC square. From equation number 2, I'll be dividing both the sides by the term IDC. So this gives us IAC upon IDC is equal to square root IRMS square upon the term IDC square minus IDC square upon IDC square. Because as we divide by IDC, and when we take the term IDC into the square root sign, the terms automatically square up. So here we get IAC upon IDC is equal to square root IRMS upon IDC, the whole term square minus 1. That's the standard equation for a typical ripple factor gamma. Now, since by definition, IAC upon IDC was mathematically derived to be square root of IRMS upon IDC, the whole term square minus 1, we get gamma is equal to IAC upon IDC, which also gives us the standard expressions for the RMS current value and the DC average value of the current. So IDC is twice Im upon pi. IRMS is equal to Im upon the value root 2. So putting these two values, IRMS and IDC, back into the expression for the ripple factor gamma, we get square root of Im upon root 2, the whole term square, divided by twice Im upon pi, the whole term square minus 1. So this gives us gamma is equal to square root of pi square upon 8 minus 1. This gives us gamma is equal to 0.4834. So what does this tell us? This tells us that the ripple factor in the center tap full wave rectifier circuit is extremely high, which is approximately 48.34%. Yes, rectifier circuits do not give us pure DC. They give us pulsating DC, which has a very high amount of the ripple component present, for which we will be looking at filters later on that will be useful in minimizing or eliminating this particular ripple content to a large extent or to a large value. Ending the lecture, the mathematical analysis include the DC output or the DC average voltage VDC. The equation is given by VDC is equal to twice Vm upon pi. The DC output or the DC average current, which is given by IDC, is equal to twice Im upon pi. The AC output or the RMS voltage, technically this is the RMS value of the AC component, given by VRMS is equal to Vm by the value root 2. The RMS value of the AC current component is given by IRMS is equal to Im upon the value root 2. And finally, ripple factor gamma is given by gamma is equal to 0.4834. So this shows that you have a very large ripple content of 48.3%, which makes the center tap full wave rectifier technically useless for real life practical applications until and unless you are able to attach a filter to remove this very high ripple content from here. So this brings us to the end of the first module, the first half of the Module number 5, the full wave center tap rectifier circuit. The standard reference books and the list of textbooks exactly are the same. We have Donald Neiman, we have Adil Saitra, Kenneth Smith and Arun Chandorkar. We have Sanjeev Gupta and Santosh Gupta. And for the point of view of the reference books, we have Robert Bolstad and Louis Nashilsky. We have David Bell, Mohammad Rashid, and finally we have Salim Anand and Suresh Kumar. A lot of very good online materials are present on these sites. You have Byju's, Engineering Being Tutorial, Electronic Tutorial WS. You have allaboutcircuits.com, that's a new website which I have seen. You have electronicsnotes.com, and you have the world-class open course where by MIT, given at the address ocw.mit.edu. And finally, you have a website electriciantraining.tpub.com. That will be the end of today's session. In the next lecture, we will be seeing what are the drawbacks of the center tap full wave rectifier circuit and what is the need to have a bridge type full wave rectifier circuit. Thank you very much.